Just one second, sorry. I'm trying to start the UK. Yeah, okay. So this talk is also available on stream live on YouTube. So Prashant is the CEO of Curet AI, which develops deep learning technology to automate interpretation of radiology exams like X-rays and CT scans. We focus on diagnosis of pulmonary diseases and critical brain pathology. And they have had phenomenal impact over the whole world, about 200 healthcare facilities in about 40 countries, impacting potentially 4 million lives annually. And particularly cool is the foray into remote healthcare, helping teams where on-site radiology expertise is low. And that is truly bringing AI to the masses. And the last year has been pretty busy for them. They've got a breakthrough US FDA clearance, partnership with AstraZeneca and Fujifilm, which I believe Prashant will talk more about. So I'm all excited to learn more about how they built the tech to automate radiology from ground up and went on to have global impact. So thank you, Prashant, for agreeing to give this talk and please. I met Prashant when they were starting off with the company and this venture, and ever since then I have watched with absolute delight how they've grown and have had impact. So it's a great occasion for me to learn about how they grew and the tech and the history. Yeah, so over to you, Prashant.
Thank you so much, Nishant. So Nishant and I went to, I was in IIT Delhi and Nishant was in IIT Kharagpur. Pretty much the same 4 years, 1997 to 2001.
Yes.
We have common friends, and I'm sure, at least a lot of my friends went to IIT Kharagpur, and I'm sure Nishant's friends also went to IIT Delhi. So it's I think this is a very close relationship, though. We met only once. We met once about 4 or 5 years ago in Bangalore, in the Philips Innovation Campus, I think, and very interesting meeting back then. So thanks, Nishant, for having me here. And it's an honor to present in front of this group. And typically, I end up presenting nowadays, in my current role, to mostly medical practitioners, to hospitals, radiology groups, investors. So to actually present in front of a data science group, I did that 3-4 years ago, but nowadays I don't do that very often. So it's an honor to present in front of this group. So look forward to having a free-flowing conversation. See, I prefer to if you have any questions, just feel free to ask either on chat or raise your hand and ask that question verbally. Just wanted to have a free-flowing conversation. I will go through some material. I will talk about our journey at Cure and what we have built out. First, introduce Cure to begin with, what we have built out at Cure. I'll talk about how medical AI is a little bit difficult and more different from the typical AI that you see a lot of other companies work on. And then thirdly, I'll talk about what it takes to build radiology AI products, what it takes to build actually any kind of AI product, right? Because we only hear about the radio, we only hear about the machine learning part of it. Everybody talks about, okay, this is cute. There's this cool algorithm that these guys have developed and it's somehow it's working and it's working wonders, right? But the reality is that the algorithm development is probably only like 20%, 25% of the overall effort that goes into actually building and commercializing AI. And a lot of people don't see that. It's like the tip of the iceberg, right? You see the AI, you feel like that algorithm is the core of it, which is true. It's the core of it. But then there's a lot of engineering, a lot of other things that go into actually building a complete product. I talk about some of the experiences that I have had as part of Cure in building these kinds of products. So I'll go into a short presentation and talk about our journey. And if you have any questions, feel free to ask, feel free to reach out, feel free to raise a hand or ask in this Q&A.
Yeah, and I'll periodically interrupt and both ask my question and convey the questions. For people who have just joined or who are not really familiar, there's a chat box on the right-hand side where you can throw in your questions and I'll periodically tell them, Prashant. And we know that this is a virtual medium, so I'd like to remind everybody to come forth and ask your questions. We have had very exciting, very engaging technical sessions earlier, and it's all because the audience has participated very well. Please
I just had one point. It looks like I have to log out of Chrome to
Okay.
get access to the presentation. I
So
cannot share presentation without going out of here. So I'll probably have to log out and come back in.
that's fine. Yeah.
Yeah.
So please log out and that won't be it. Again, thank you guys for joining this afternoon. If you have any questions at this point, please feel free to throw them in the chat box. And Prashant will be joining us very soon. There are people joining in, still joining in. So welcome to the session. And we had a little bit of a hiccup. Prashant will be joining us very soon. This talk is part of the Offnode Lab AI series. If you want to know more about Offnode Labs, there's a link I have put in. Sure, I can tell you more about the work that we do. Yeah, so I can maybe give you a brief intro about Offnode Labs. Offnode Labs is a platform for individuals to learn to research. There's no PhD involved here. Basically, we encourage eager young self-learners to who really want to do research to pursue our AI research program. Why we do this? Well, what's the observation behind this? So with democratization of knowledge, particularly in the AI field, we've seen a rapid increase in eager and self-learners. And our belief is that with mentoring, they will really rise and shine. And why research? Research is not, at least in our point of view, it's not a purely academic activity. It requires having a lot of grit, struggling with problems, flourishing with uncertainty, and finally discovering your own paths and ways of solving the problem and aiming for impact. So it's sort of a wholesome training, if you will, when you go through the research process. And our goal is to facilitate that process among eager young students. So we're looking for young researchers who want to build cutting-edge stuff, and most importantly, who are self-driven. This is not your assignments, or class assignments, or a project that is given to you and you just trying to finish it. Given a lot of mentorship, but we require you to be self-driven in trying to, you know, set up milestones and achieve your goals. And we also look for mentors who want to pursue open research without constraints on problems that they're very passionate about. So that's a brief summary of Node Labs. And if you're interested, then you can go to offnode.co/apply. Question: what's the expectation from Offnode Labs candidate? We mostly focus on AI projects right now. So there is a certain skill level of familiarity with deep learning that is required. You can't be an absolute beginner and jump into research project. You have to have done some projects, done some exploration. So familiarity with both theory and the tools. And maybe some familiarity with reading people as well. Hey, Prashant, welcome back.
Back here, but somehow I don't think it's still working for me.
Oh, man. Okay. So can you share the link with me and I can...
I can send you the presentation. Let me just look at that. I'll just email you the presentation.
Okay.
It's huge also because I just put together some slides, right? It's very big.
Okay. So what is the problem? You are...
I'm not able to share my screen. And when I share my screen, it says browser is not permitted to share the screen.
Okay.
And I am going to privacy and screen recording and doing all of that. But that is not enabled. You know, when you go to screen recording, somehow I'm not able to change that here. I'm not sure why that is happening.
And these slides are on your computer. They're not Google slides or something.
I could upload them on Google. But do you think that will help? Let me convert to PDF. Maybe let me convert to PDF. Yeah, I think there's a PDF option here. Let me convert to PDF. That will be easy. Yeah, let me do that.
Yeah. Sorry, guys. We're having a little bit of a hiccup today. But hopefully very soon it will be over. And yeah, so I was talking a bit about Offnode Labs. And besides some experience with deep learning, what we need most importantly is the self-driven nature and your own desire to explore the problems and dig deep into it without being, you know, handheld. Now I can see. Wonderful.
Got it, yeah. Somehow it was not working on Chrome screen share, but I converted to PDF and this works. Just
okay.
For future reference, I think. Something to...
technology, both to our...
Yeah.
To our help.
Yeah. So good to get started. And if you want to finish, Nishant, please go ahead.
Yes, so I think that answered your question, Abhishek. A little bit of experience in deep learning and most importantly, self-driven nature. And you receive a lot of mentorship and you'll figure out a project that suits both the student and our interest, the mentor's interest. And the process is a bit uncertain, but that's the fun of it. It's sort of a treasure hunt, I like to call it. Treasure hunt, and it's a very unique experience that most people don't get until they start master's or PhD. So yeah, if you're interested, if you know somebody's interested, please ask them to apply offnode.co/apply. Okay, so that's the brief intro. And finally, we are ready to learn all about Cure AI and medical AI and how they change the world. Yeah. Go ahead, please. Yeah.
Thanks everyone for the patience. Somehow, I mean, I couldn't get my screen share to work as a techie. I feel very bad about it, but anyway, I will briefly introduce myself and then talk about Cure for a bit. and then talk about some of the experiences at Cure. So I am a data scientist by training. I mean, back when I was doing my PhD, it was not called data science. I did a PhD in operations research back in 2001 and worked on a lot of problems in trucking optimization. So I was optimizing trucking networks in the US and figuring out how how shipments need to be packed into trucks, and then how do you assign drivers? The driver assignment problem is similar to the crew scheduling problems in airlines. So a lot of problems that I worked on back in the early part of 2000s, 2001 to 2010. And I spent a lot of time after that. I graduated from Georgia Tech, I did a PhD from there, went to work with SAP in 2006. So with SAP, again, I was working on as a data scientist. At that time, again, it was not called a data scientist, it was called a research scientist. And I was working on many demand forecasting, retail demand forecasting, merchandise planning, price optimization, markdown optimization, many problems with respect to retail customers, people like Kmart or a Safeway, also with somebody like Apollo, Ralph Lauren, Esprit. So again, there are differences in terms of fashion products versus regular products, and then pricing is different. So again, figuring out the pricing models for all of those. Came back to India about 10 years ago and set up one startup, which was in the advertising technology space. So we're using data from a lot of e-commerce companies, working with a lot of e-commerce companies back in 2011-12, to use that to then target the right ads at customers. So build that ad tech technology, which got acquired by a company called Fractal, and then set up Cure 5 years ago, focused on AI in the medical imaging space. And with Cure, I mean, we have grown pretty well. Actually, from the time we COVID started, we have grown almost like 10x in the last 1.5 years. And not because of COVID, just because that sort of hockey stick growth that you have in a startup. So you build technology, AI startup or with any kind of AI startup, basically you build technology and then you commercialize it and then you have that hockey stick growth. In the medical space, that is even longer, because what happens is these are medical devices, these are regulated products. So you cannot really build a product and start selling it. You have to actually go through an FDA clearance or a CE certification. And so then commercializing it becomes a little bit slower. So by the time you're able to start from start to commercialization, it's about a 3 to 4 year journey. And then you start commercializing, then you see that growth. Right? So that is what is happening with us right now. Today, Cure is in about 45 plus countries, close to 48 countries now. We are close to sites globally where we are being used. And we touch about 4 million lives annually. So about 4 million scans on an annual basis. That is where we are. And this is, again, growing very rapidly. So these numbers are like 10x of what they were a year back, and probably will be hopefully 10x of where they are a year from now. So again, looking to grow pretty rapidly. And one thing that we have always is that we want to grow along with the community in this space, right? We want to contribute to the community. We want to contribute to other researchers who are working on this. So we have most of the work that we have done has been published in medical journals. We have got a lot of validation studies. We have even published our algorithms in some of these journals. And we've got 40 plus publications right now in some of the top medical journals, for example, Lancet or Nature Scientific, Lancet Digital Health. So a lot of some of the top journals we've got publications. And of course, I mean, as I mentioned earlier, these are products which are regulated products. So we've got FDA clearance for the US. We've got CE certification for Europe. And we have got local certifications in so many different countries, from Brazil to Argentina to Vietnam, Philippines. So a lot of Southeast Asia, a lot of Latin America, and almost all of Middle East. So we've got local certifications across these countries as well. So today we commercialize these products in about 60 countries directly and also with distributors. And again, happy to talk about our commercial pathway, but today I'll focus more on the tech part of what we have built out. So I'll talk about, I know that a lot of people here are data scientists, and you have worked on some data science problems, right? But what we do not anticipate is that when we started Cure, we knew that obviously medical imaging is a hard problem, but we did not anticipate why it is harder, right? And I'll go to the next slide. I think in the PDF format, the slide won't look very good, but This is, I mean, typically I show these three slides, show these three x-rays and ask people which one is abnormal. And I think, I mean, I've never seen anybody present it, I mean, actually identify it correctly, except for some doctors' conferences where people actually identify, yeah, this is the right one, right? But the point is that, see, I mean, in this particular three x-rays, this one x-ray is abnormal, and it is abnormal because of a very small pleural effusion here. So what do you call a pleural effusion? Some very small fluid collection in this corner, right? And this is something which is so hard. It's a very, very small part of the x-ray. And to do this requires what? I mean, it requires about 20, 25 years of training. I mean, you have to go through high school, then go through a medical degree, then go through a radiology degree, and then you're able to identify that this particular small spot is abnormal on that x-ray. Everything else looks normal, right? So to be able to do that requires a huge amount of skill. And compared to like the kinds of tasks that you see in, I mean, ImageNet and all of those where you're trying to identify cats or dogs or ships or aeroplanes, this is far more skilled. This requires a huge, a significantly higher skill to be able to detect that particular abnormality on that particular x-ray. And it's also, other part is that when you look at those cat images or dog images, the cats or the dogs occupy almost half the image or at least one fourth of the image. Here you're talking about some 20, 30 pixels that are abnormal. Everything else is almost normal. Everything else is, in fact, normal here. Right? So that is very tough. I mean, you're basically trying to train an algorithm on a very, very difficult task, which actually applies to a very small portion of that image. And then you have to train that algorithm to learn that particular abnormality. So that is first. Right?
So if I may ask, so it's a few pixels, right? So even doctors who are trained to do this, do they, I mean, this is probably a lame question, do they have a habit of squinting at every corner, because even I, it's a, or it's just they're trained to know where to enter.
So I think, you know, it's, I mean, now, I mean, of course, I'm not a doctor, but I have been looking at chest x-rays for about 4 or 5 years now. And I can see, I mean, the first thing you look for is these corners, you know, these are called the costophrenic angles. So you're looking at these corners, they should be very sharp. This is very sharp, for example, this is very sharp, this is sharp here, this is sharp here. This one, it's not sharp, right? It's basically, there is some fluid there. So you know what to look for. And there is something called A, B, C, D, E, F. They have a way of reading it. So they start looking at airways. A, B is bones. And C is something, I mean, I'm trying to recollect now.
That's fine, yeah. Yeah, it's very interesting. They have a
method of looking at these x-rays. And this is something that comes up all the time because you're looking at effusion. In fact, my dad was in the ICU recently and exactly the same thing. I mean, he had some fluid here. And I could figure that out because, I mean, I've been looking at x-rays all this time. So I know, yeah, there is this fluid. So people who have trained on doing this know exactly what to look for. But for a average, I mean, normal human eye will not be able to figure this out, right? It doesn't look abnormal at all. It looks practically normal.
Just a quick note that we can't see your mouse pointer. So maybe you'll have to just spell it. Yeah.
You can see the circle, right? The circle that is there. So that is the abnormality is. Mm-hmm. So this is the point. Yeah, we cannot see the mouse pointer, right? Is there a way to show the pointer? No.
I don't know.
If it's a share screen, probably you can see it. Otherwise, no, right? So, but yeah, this is the point. I mean, the where you have the circle there, that is where the abnormality is. And when you cross, that is the abnormal x-ray. Or the first x-ray that you see is the abnormal x-ray. So moving on to the next, so I think there are some questions here, right? What is the scope for mechanical engineers in this field? I would say, I mean, it's basically very open. I mean, anybody can do this. I am also a mechanical engineer, by the way. So you can study anything. I mean, as long as you spend the time building out, working on these problems. And I think there is some part of studying where you're studying about these technologies, but also it's about trying it out. You have to have a lot of hands-on experience and download some open source data sets, build some algorithms, try out some models and keep on learning from there. And anybody can do it. I don't think it is limited to only computer science engineers or anybody who's done a, let's say, certain kind of machine learning degree, for example. Right? So, and I'm sure Nishant can add a lot more color to this.
Sure. Yeah. I think you have built a team and the specific skills required for this kind of these kinds of problems might be, you might have more insight into that. Yeah. I think there are a bunch of questions also. How do you make sure that the models learn to look for exactly the right regions in the X-ray image? Want some background? And what is the resolution of X-ray pictures you use in JPG or do you connect to PIX?
Yeah, so I'll talk about that X-ray exact regions in the X-ray image. That's the problem we are solving basically. So I'll talk about how we solve that, right? I'll talk about that. Again, X-ray pictures, JPEGs, I'll talk about that. In case of misdiagnosis, who bears the responsibility? That's a very, very good question. At this point, this is only an assistive tool. So the responsibility of the interpretation is finally with the radiologist who uses this technology and reports the X-ray or CT scan or MRI or ultrasound. So we don't bear the responsibility right now, but we will see how that evolves. I mean, it's again similar to autonomous vehicles, right? If a driver has an accident in an autonomous vehicle, I mean, the responsibility lies with the driver, not with the autonomous capability. Even for all the autonomous capabilities that are still there, right? For example, the Tesla autonomous capability and so on, which is where exactly, you know, becoming fully autonomous requires a lot of liability and legal questions that you have to solve for, which we have not solved yet. But right now, what we are providing is a tool which can help doctors, radiologists and physicians interpret X-rays more accurately and much faster. So then I'll talk about some of the other questions. I'll talk about them in a bit. Second point, I think why these are hard is that if you look at typical computer vision or NLP problems, I mean, again, there are so many data sources online, right? ImageNet, and I mean, I don't know what else. I mean, there are like hundreds of data sources that are available online, open source images, open source labeled data, right? When it comes to radiology data, we had to build that database from scratch. And I can tell you, I spent about a year and a half of my first year. In fact, when I met Nishant also, I had come down to Bangalore because I was meeting some hospitals there. And to build out the data set, you have to partner with a lot of healthcare organizations to build out that data set so that you can train the algorithms. And today we have a very unique data set. And what you typically, I mean, when you look at a lot of other companies, they don't have that. I mean, for us, the data set itself is an advantage. That is a moat because we have so much data. We have about more than 1 billion images in our database. And that is something that nobody else in the world has. So purely because of the amount of data we have very, very accurate algorithms. And for somebody else to come back and train their algorithms and to get to the same level of accuracy, of course, maybe they can build the technology layer. Maybe they can build the same neural networks and everything else, but they will not have the same amount of data. So it's very hard. So we have that moat around the, when you look, talk about companies, there is that differentiator, right? So differentiator is around the data, around the algorithms, around the deployments and so many other things. And so that is a big problem initially, but also becomes a differentiator for you actually when you try to build these models.
And by data, you mean annotated data. So again, there are two parts, getting X-rays images. Real X-ray is also not, I would believe it's not that easy, but getting labels on the is doubly hard or exponentially hard. So yeah. So when you say this data, which part or both parts?
No, so I'll talk about that. I'll talk about that in a bit. Sure. I'm going to talk about some of that. Yeah. So third thing is that, I mean, again, 99% is probably an overrepresentation, but a lot of deep learning research is performed on a standard image size, right? I mean, you have got 224 pixels. I mean, that is the typical image size that you train models on. And when you compare that to an X-ray, this is the difference. You know, X-ray is like 4,000 pixels by 4,000 pixels. So that image of the panda is like so small as compared to the X-ray. And when you're trying to train a model on this size of image, and you imagine you're trying to train a classification or a segmentation algorithm, it becomes very big. And it doesn't fit into the RAM. I mean, so it's too big that you cannot really put that whole image together and train that model at the same time. So then what you have to do is, I mean, one of the things, I mean, we have done is to actually segment out. So we actually take that and we segment this out into smaller parts. Then we can run classification algorithms on a smaller set of the smaller part of the image. So again, that's something which is, again, very unique to, in fact, only to X-rays. So even CT scans are not so big. X-rays, because they're only a single image, they are very big. And coming to this again, this was actually a video, so I cannot show that on the PDF. But what you see here on this video is that this is basically a CT scan, and it's got about 1,000 slices. So a CT scan is basically a slice. I mean, you're taking slices of the chest. This is a chest CT scan. You're taking slices of the chest and you have 1,000 slices. So what a radiologist is looking at is each of those 1,000 slices to figure out if there is any abnormality in that. And when you look at that, you have got like some very, very small nodules. I mean, some very small circles you'll see on that, which are abnormal. And that becomes very hard. And when I show the video, you'll see that it's very, very small. And you have to be able to pick out that needle in a haystack in this while building that algorithm. So that again becomes a tougher problem because you're training with large images and then you're training with three-dimensional images. So that becomes one more challenge that comes in with this kind of technology. And then I'll talk about data labeling, but maybe I can take some questions in between that. You know, to use GitHub. So I'm not sure I understand the question, SJ, I mean, about using data captured during other medical exams. Maybe you can ask them, maybe you can share more detail either on chat or.
Yeah, I think he, I mean, blood pressure, heart rate, pulse rate, that's what he means. Other data captured during medical
Yeah, so you can definitely use that. I mean, finally, the idea is that you are trying to create a diagnosis using the data that you have. And one part of the data is the image data, but you can potentially use blood pressure, heart rate, pulse. I mean, you can bring all of those data to bear, but the challenge usually is that getting all the data together is hard, right? I mean, X-ray data is very easy because, I mean, by law, a lot of organizations have to maintain records of X-rays for the last 7 years. So if you took an X-ray 7 years ago, a hospital is required to have that exam with them for 7 years. Whereas for, I mean, and then typically for blood pressure, heart rate, and all that, that data is not available. So you have to then work on a prospective data collection exercise. Right now, what we did is we went to hospitals and said, give me your last 7 years data. And we got that data, we trained models on that. But what you could do is you can say, okay, I want to now start collecting X-ray data along with all these parameters. And I want that for the next 2 years. So you go through a 2-year exercise to collect that data, and then you take all of that to train your models. That is possible. We have not done that. We have not done that with our algorithm because, again, it's a little bit longer term development process. What we are doing now is, as we are deploying these algorithms, we are collecting not blood pressure, heart rate, pulse data, but we are collecting symptoms data. So we know that patients are coming with certain symptoms. We know their diagnosis. So we correlate all of that to create a better model. That is something that we work on now. And so that's there. When you segment, you might lose big picture. Am I right? That is right. I mean, that is right. So you have to actually, we have several ways to handle that. So what we do is we take the X-ray, we segment out the different parts of the lung. So we basically create six different parts of it. And then we also downsize the big X-ray. So you have a big picture X-ray. So you have, let's say, the 4,000 by 4,000 pixel X-ray that is converted into 500 by 500. So that goes as one in a classification algorithm, that goes as one channel. And then you've got the individual channels for each of the parts of the X-ray. So one part is the, let's say, the left upper lung, one part is the left lower lung. So something like that. So it's something like that where you are actually passing in the big picture as well as the smaller slices, smaller parts of the chest as well. So coming to, I think, data labeling, right? I mean, like you asked, Nishant, so I think annotation is critical. And for a lot of segmentation problems, you cannot survive without annotation, right? You cannot, I mean, obviously, these are supervised learning algorithms, so you have to have annotations. What we have done is pretty clever in some ways. I mean, some of the areas we've done some very clever things. I'll talk about that, right? But this is, for example, the head CT algorithm, right? That on the head CT technology, you've got a brain scan. And you've got slices. So basically, you've got like 100 slices of the brain. This is one slice. And this is a bleed that you see. What you see on the screen here, which is marked out, is a bleed in the brain. So you now, what you do is you give these slices to a radiologist and you have them mark out the abnormal regions on each slice. You've got 100 slices. You can probably out of 100 slices, maybe 10, 15 slices have an abnormality. The rest will be normal. So somebody will go in, mark out each slice. And then they'll be done. And then they will keep, I mean, we'll give them one more and so on. We have got about 300,000 slices, 300,000 exams. So we have got 300,000 head CTs. So if you can imagine, we have got 30 million such slices. And if you have to then train an algorithm to, I mean, no, sorry, if you have to get a radiologist to mark all of that, that will take them hundreds of years. So you cannot do that for every scan, every slice. So we have done this for about, I would say, maybe 30, 40,000 slices where we have gone in and marked out in detail what where the abnormality is. This takes about 10 minutes to do, right? But for a lot of others, we do something like this, where we say this particular slice is normal or abnormal. So you've got 100 slices. In that, you have to say slice number 5 is abnormal, 6 is abnormal, 7 is abnormal, 8 is abnormal, rest are all normal. That is a much easier task. That whole task, through this, you can actually basically label the whole exam in about 5 minutes. Whereas in that, you had to take, per slice, you had to take about 10 minutes. You're doing this much faster using this kind of labeling. So we've done this as well, where this is basically some level of soft labeling, right? Now, go ahead, Misha.
But again, radiologists have to be involved there. There's a decent skill level needed even for this soft label.
So what we did is that a lot of labeling is done by interns who are not radiologists, and some of the more difficult, so they can label some of the easier exam. Some of them are more difficult, so they will say, okay, I cannot do this. We will get a radiologist to do it.
So a layered approach, easy and then hard. And,
yes. 80% of the labeling is done by interns, and then 20% is done by someone.
And before this use case, I mean, before you guys came here, at the medical, sorry, there's some background, the medical analytics, you know, stream started using deep learning too. Was there any culture of labeling these X-rays among in the medical community itself, or for what whatever reason?
There was not.
So all of this has started
maybe 5 years ago. So all of this whole labeling process only started 5 years ago, and I think there is a real now. I mean, this basically it's a whole job profile, that labeling annotation that's come up in the last 5 years. So this is one kind of labeling. Now, one of the challenges, we have about 4 million X-rays and their corresponding reports. Right now, if you have 4 million X-rays, imagine you have to go and label each of those 4 million X-rays, mark it out. That's about, if you take 10 minutes per 10 minutes per X-ray, you're talking about 40 million minutes. It's huge. I mean, it's basically millions of hours that you have to spend in labeling these X-rays. And that's not, I mean, you cannot, that's basically hundreds and hundreds of years to label that. So we cannot do that, right? So one of the things that we did is we had the X-ray and the corresponding report. Now, the radiology report has a lot of detail. It tells you exactly what the abnormality is, where it is, which part of the lung is affected, right? So it will tell you, for example, there is a consolidation in the lower left lung. So now what we built out is what you'll see on the next slide. Built out a technology which can take the data. So this is, for example, the report that is created by the radiologist, and you take that and convert it to labels. Now we again, these are rule based. We try to do some machine learning based labeling, but these are rule based labels where we are able to then take that X-ray report and find out that there is a blunted CP angle, there is a cardiomegaly, there is a pleural effusion, there is an aortic knuckle calcification, all from the report itself. So this is rule-based NLP, which is run on the X-ray machine, X-ray report, to create this, create the classifications. Similarly, we have rule-based labeling for head CT scans, for a lot of other modalities as well. But this becomes very critical, because when you're looking at labeling so much data, you really cannot go and manually label all of it. So then our sort of approach is that we have manual labels for a subset of, think about X-rays. 4 million X-rays, we have manual labels for maybe about 100,000 X-rays. So there you have the segmentation where you can actually mark out where the abnormality is, and that's a segmentation pathway. But in the same, we also have a classification pathway where we are able to mark out what the abnormality is. We have the labeling from a classification perspective. We know that whether this particular X-ray has got blunted CP angle or not, whether this X-ray has got cardiomegaly or not. And then you have a classification model that is trained on this. And then adding to that, we also have a model where we are able to also identify where exactly this abnormality is. Because sometimes, I mean, they will say left lower zone is hazy with blunting of costophrenic angle. So now you can say that the blunted costophrenic angle is in the left lower zone. So it's in the left, it's in the lower. So we take that information also and put it in the classification algorithm. And so basically, you've got a classification pathway and a segmentation pathway, which incorporate all of the data that is available to us. One is the annotated scans. some are the report based annotations that we have created. And this then is the overall architecture for us, which goes into building of the models. And as I mentioned, I mean, again, because these picture sizes are very large, we also have some, we also sort of segment it out into smaller parts so that we can run it through the classification engine.
Yeah, so there are a bunch of questions.
I'll just pause for questions. Yeah. So, medical imaging, the set of images are defined, so the abnormality can be found comparatively easy. How can one use such kind of algorithms in a more complex field, such as detection of critical engineering structures? I think, you know, that's, I mean, we actually, that's a good point. Actually, I didn't mention this, but why we pick these head CT scan and chest X-rays, because chest X-ray is always standard. It's a chest, right? And you are basically training an algorithm on something which is standardized. Head CT scan is also very standard. But if you look at abdominal X-rays could be upper abdomen, lower abdomen, could be multiple parts. If you look at musculoskeletal X-rays, you will be looking at X-rays of the, let's say, elbow joint or the knee joint or the wrist joint. So that becomes very varied. And you are, I mean, of course, when the images are not standard, you are trying to train algorithms to identify a fracture. And that is also possible. See, finally, I think where we are doing something like this, you can have a classification approach. And you can do classification on this kind of a problem. But when you're looking at doing something where, let's say, what maybe you're working on musculoskeletal X-rays, you've got wrist fractures and knee fractures and elbow fractures. You have a segmentation-based approach where you have an image where you then mark out the, annotate the abnormal region, abnormal, let's say the fracture in that. And then that goes into your segmentation model. So I think that's one way to approach this. And I would say if you have a lot of images of critical engineering structures, you basically would have somebody label out all the abnormal regions, abnormal areas in that particular engineering structure, and then use that to train a model. That's one way to think about it. Again, I mean, I'm sure there are many other ways to think about that kind of problem. But I mean, I can relate from the kind of musculoskeletal X-rays where we did not have a standard image structure.
Yeah, so a couple of questions following. So maybe you can answer them now or later on in the batch. It depends on.
No, we can answer them now.
Sure.
Okay. How do you make sure that there is no bias in the data collected with regards to age, ethnicity, etc.? So this is, you know, this is some of the toughest questions in ML and AI right now, and nobody's answered them well. I think the reality is that there will be some bias in any kind of AI technology because you are training it on data that you have, and no data can be fully representative of everything, right? One thing you can do is you can make sure you are enriching your data in certain ways so that you train the models for different things. For example, I'll talk about how we do this, right? If you look at 4 million X-rays, the number of cases where there is cardiomegaly, which is one kind of abnormality, will be about 500,000, or maybe will be about 200,000. Number of cases where you have a nodule will be about 20,000-30,000, which is again one kind of abnormality. Number of cases that you have a pneumothorax will be like maybe 1,000, right? So then you have to, what you do is, for us, I mean, what we've done is we have trained different models for each of them. And then we create a data set for each of those problems where you're saying, okay, is there pneumothorax in this or not? And then you solve that problem using a data set, which is a subset of the data that you have, so that you're not over, you don't have a large amount of one kind of data and a smaller amount of another kind of data. So you enrich your data set in a way that you're able to train these individual models well. That is one. I think the other part is that you have to actually get data from multiple sources, especially from a AI medical imaging perspective. X-ray is very much dependent upon what kind of machine you have. And if you have a Philips machine or a Siemens machine, probably the algorithm might work on a Philips machine, may not work on a Siemens machine. So again, being able to get data from multiple sources, multiple hospitals, multiple countries, that is important. And you have to make it as diverse as possible. But again, there will be some bias. I mean, obviously, I think it's almost impossible to remove all the bias in the AI. But try to make the data very diverse. And one of the things that we have certainly seen is that ethnicity-based diversity is not required because the anatomy of a human being is the same. So whether you are in US or Africa or India, I mean, the algorithm performs at the same level of accuracy. And so that again is important because you want to be able to test. You want to be able to test the technology on a US data set, on a, even if you trained only on an Indian data set, for example, you still want to be able to test it on a US data set and an African data set and a Chinese data set so that you can see whether it is working on that kind of data set or not. So you need to do a lot in terms of making the data diverse. You also need to do a lot in terms of testing to make sure that the technology is performing on different data sets. And especially for AI, I mean, for medical AI, that is critical because you'll not get a, if you get want to get an FDA clearance, you have to test it on US data. If you want to get a CE certification, ideally, they will want you to test it on a European population. So that kind of testing is critical for medical AI, but also in general, I would say it's important to test on multiple data sets. Next question is, are you able to obtain and compare scans for the same patient over time? Would that time-based differing increase accuracy of algorithm? So absolutely. I mean, I think we are able to do that. We more than improving the accuracy of the algorithm, what we're doing is, if you're looking at lung cancer, for example, let's say there is a small nodule on the chest X-ray, right? That could be cancer. Now, first time you take an X-ray, let's say 2017, you have that nodule. When you take an X-ray 2018, if that nodule is the same size, then most likely it's not a lung cancer. So you're actually then comparing multiple X-rays taken in a longitudinal manner to be able to figure out if a certain finding is malignant or not. So, or for COVID X-rays, we quantify the abnormalities. We say the amount of percentage of lung that is infected due to COVID is 20%. And then after 2 weeks, it becomes 10%. So obviously you're measuring how much of the lung is infected and you're able to quantify and measure progression. So we do some of that, but not to improve accuracy, but to be able to measure the progression of disease, either COVID or lung cancer, tuberculosis, COPD, a lot of different things. Next question is most of your work supervised learning? Yes. I mean, 100% of what we do is supervised. So there is hardly any unsupervised learning or zero unsupervised learning at Cure. How do you think about the quality assurance of a model trained to assist in medical decision? How do you think about maintaining quality over time? So this is actually a very important part of medical AI, that you have to have a quality system. You will not get an FDA clearance. You'll not get a CE certification if you don't have a quality management system. And you have to keep on doing quality checks of your technology. You have to keep on maintaining quality from a product development perspective, product usage perspective. And beyond that, what we have built out is, we built out a model where we have a quality assurance model where every day, about 1 to 2% of the scans that we receive for processing on the cloud, they are sent to a radiologist for reading. So then the radiologist will compare, okay, the algorithm said it was abnormality A, and it was actually abnormality B, so this is wrong. So they will know exactly what is the error rate from that. So we are actually on a daily basis, we are monitoring the error rate. And if we see that the error rate is high in general or for a certain hospital or certain customer, we will then go back and say, okay, there is something wrong here. We need to figure this out. We need to solve this. So that is something that we do on a very ongoing, on an ongoing basis. And last question is, if more than one abnormality are observed, we will identify all the abnormalities. So in fact, how the training works in this case is that we have a model for blunted CP angle, right? So now what we do is we'll take those 10,000 X-rays where blunted CP angle is present, and then we'll take maybe like 500,000 X-rays, which are representative of the data set, which is basically a randomly selected data from all the other sort of 3,990,000 X-rays. And those are then combined, and then you train a model on blunted CP angle. Similarly, if you have cardiomegaly, you will do the same thing. You will train a model on cardiomegaly with some cases which have cardiomegaly and some which are representative data. So population data, basically, and train each of the models like that. And there are some ways where we are combining these also. So some of these models also, it's a classification where rather than saying blunted CP angle, yes or no, cardiomegaly, yes or no, we're saying, are there all of these at the same time? So we are basically classifying all of them at the same time. So multi-label classification. But typically, we've seen that the dichotomous classification actually works pretty well. So we don't have to look at that multi-label classification in most situations.
So your deployment use, or deployment setup is is that you take an image of a person in the present time, or you take it a sequence of images from the past, or there are two modes in which the software operates, or maybe there are other modes.
No, so we already have the historical data. So we know the X-rays that came in the past. We know that this X-ray for this person came in a year ago. This was the X-ray came 6 months ago. This is the X-ray. So today, when you get an X-ray, we process that X-ray. We also process the historical X-rays. We already have the results for those. Then we compare. Then we compare this X-ray against the historical X-rays and create a report. So we create an X-ray report, which is the report for that particular X-ray. But we also create a progression report on whether there is a progression of lung cancer or COVID or whatever. It's, right? So we do that as well.
Mm-hmm. So this progression report creation is a different problem. It's a sort of aggregation problem. Or exactly. Maybe it's not that complicated.
It's not a very complicated problem. Basically, just processing multiple X-rays and combining the results. It's basically that, yeah. It's not, as a problem, it's not so complex. Does the X-ray scan of a disease look the same across demographics, old versus young, European versus Asian, or do you have some canonical precursor transmission image? So X-ray looks the same across ethnicities, but across male versus female, it does not look the same. Across old versus young, it does not look the same. So age groups matter, male versus female matters, but otherwise, across ethnicities, it looks the same. And we have, obviously, there's a lot of pre-processing that goes into the image as well. So we pre-process and transform the image before it is processed, before it is passed on to the classification deep learning algorithm. Does that answer your question, SJ? I don't know if you have any further questions on that. Assuming your supervised models are trained continuously to improve accuracy, when you push models into production, then the certification will be required for the new model that you're putting. Yeah, so that is a very, very important point. In fact, when you are training these models, FDA requires you to precisely define what model you are getting approved. And then if you have a newer version of that model, or if you cannot do ongoing learning, even if you're doing ongoing learning, you cannot put that into production. You can do learning on an ongoing basis, but that feedback will be going into a model which will sit separately. And then you can, if you want to deploy that in production, you have to go through with a second FDA clearance, which is simpler, but you have to tell them that, okay, I'm changing the model. And this is the efficacy, this is the accuracy of the model. This is better than the previous model. And I'm going to go live with this. And that's probably a 6 month to 9 month process. So it's a important part. We cannot on a continuous basis keep on learning and keep on improving the model. Unfortunately, in healthcare, it doesn't work that way. Yeah.
When you said you specify what changed in the model, what kind of artifact do you talk
so
about?
So they don't care about what changed. They care about the accuracy of the model.
Output.
And whether the accuracy has improved. Only output. They don't care about what is inside that black box. They only want to look at the output.
And what went into the black box? What all data did you use to?
Again, they don't care.
They don't care. So output performance is what?
Yeah.
And then there's a table of performance, not just one value.
So you have a lot of different things, right? Sensitivity, specificity, a lot of different factors that you have to look into. So that performance, again, that is, you want to look at that performance, like you said, across different age groups, across male, female, across different ethnicities, could be many ways, right? So they want to measure that performance and they want to see that the performance is better across all groups. If the performance drops even in one group, it becomes a challenge. So if, let's say, initially when we went to the FDA, they said, your performance on CT scans, I spoke about the slices, right? Mm-hmm. Now, when there are slices, you can have slices which are 0.5 mm or 1 mm or 2 mm. So you can have different slices. And one of the things that the FDA asked for is, how does your algorithm perform on different kind of slice ranges? If the slice is 0.5 mm, what is the performance? If the slice is 5 mm, what is the performance? And actually, in one of those kinds of slices, the performance was not great. And then they said, okay, you have to improve that model. So you have to go back and improve that model and go back to them with all of that. So there's a lot of questions. They want to understand everything about the model across all the different classifications you could have in the data. And then
so they get insight into the black box through these many slices of performance tables, I guess.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, I'll just, so we are 30, 40 minutes into the talk, and the amount of, I think we have covered huge amount of ground, thanks to those wonderful questions, and then of course, thanks to Prashant, just, you know, sweeping the whole space very quickly and answering just to the point. So it's amazing. Thank you, audience, and thanks. Yeah, please, Prashant, continue. Yeah.
I think I'll have probably 5-10 more minutes of presentation.
You can continue, but
That's from your So I'll talk about some of the lessons learned from building AI products, right? And this is very interesting. I mean, some of the different things that we have learned over time. So one is the trust in the algorithm, right? I mean, when we go to a hospital, go to a radiology group, go to a government, they want to be able to trust the technology, right? And I mean, reality is you have different things. These are two articles from New York Times. One is Dr. Pigeon, which was able to identify, I think, breast cancer from looking at breast cancer images. And this is a rat who can smell tuberculosis. Dogs can smell cancer. I mean, you can basically, I mean, it's a black box, right? I mean, you can show anything. And how do you know that your algorithm is better than this? I mean, it could be a random random data, also random production of outputs. So I think that's one. And I think what has also happened very recently is, if you, I don't know how many of you have heard the story of Theranos, right? And they went through a, I mean, they actually created a lot of buzz, and everybody was like, I mean, they're going to revolutionize pathology, digital pathology. But the reality was that they did not have any technology underlying whatever buzz they created. So they were using some commodity hardware from other companies. They did not even have their own hardware. And you are, somebody saying, no, only heard of Thanos. So you should look at Theranos also. There is a book called Bad Blood. Bad Blood is a very good book about the story of Theranos. And there is a movie also, which has either come out or is going to come out, with Jennifer Lawrence. So, but yeah, I think, so, I mean, their challenge was that, I mean, there was nothing. I mean, they did not have anything. And they promoted that, and a lot of people felt like, I mean, they got cheated because of this. And the value, basically, I mean, it became, I think, a multi, around $8 billion or something, and then went to zero pretty much in 1 year. So that, the main thing is that peer review, it was never peer reviewed. The technology was never FDA cleared. They claimed that it did not require FDA clearance. So I think it's important for people to trust algorithms, and to build that trust, you need to have some, especially in healthcare, you need to have publications, you need to have peer review. And that is something that we have done a lot, is to get a lot of peer reviewed publications out there. And anything less than that should not be acceptable, right? So peer review, FDA clearance, C-certification, need to get out there, especially for a company out of India. It becomes even more important, because people don't trust Indian companies. If you say that, okay, I have built this out of India, people will feel like, okay. I mean, so many people ask me, is this built outside of India? Are you buying this from somebody else, and then you're licensed in India? People feel like, in India, we cannot develop these kinds of technologies, right? So that is something which you have to solve for, and it's not easy. I mean, people always think that India cannot build high-end technology, and we have to change that mindset. And I think getting peer review validation is very important. And for us, we have focused on that. We have gotten validation studies with Harvard Medical School, Mass General Hospital, Beth Israel, Mayo Clinic, Stop TB partnership. So we have done a lot of different publications, a lot of different validations to show that our technology is better than radiologists and better than all the other competitors that are out there. Israeli companies, American companies, Korean companies. So we have done a lot of studies which show that we are actually comparable or better than both radiologists and competitors. And so that's something which is critical. Second is again about data. This is a data problem.
Right? So if I may quickly about the sensor groups or the, what should I call them, the gatekeepers, are they, can you count them on fingers? I mean, if they have evaluated a set of 10 organizations have evaluated your technology, then that builds enough trust. This is something you might have discovered over time, or there is no such number.
See, one or two is more than enough. I think two, three validations is good enough. Yes. But the more you have, the better. Because more you have, the more credibility you have. And if I go to somebody and say, I've got a study with NHS, I've got a study with Harvard Medical School, I've got a study with Dubai Health Authority, again, I mean, different organizations will create credibility in a different market. If I go to a hospital in UAE and say I have worked with Dubai Health Authority, that will create a lot of credibility. If I go to the US, they want to see that Harvard Medical School or Mayo Clinic study. So I think the more you have, the better. But typically, 2-3 is good enough because it shows that the algorithm is performing on an independent data set well. And that is what I'm coming to here.
And each of these studies takes a few months.
Each of the studies takes about 6 to 9 months. I mean, it depends upon how quickly they operate. Mm-hmm. Because in reality, the study is very simple. You have to have, let's say, 1,000 scans, which have to be read by a radiologist or multiple radiologists. Mm-hmm. You have to compare that to the performance of the AI. That is a basic study. Of course, you can look at prospective studies where you process a scan and then you process the AI, process it, and the radiologist reads it after that. And then you are seeing how much the accuracy of the radiologist improved because of using the AI. So you can build, you can look at studies like that also. So there are quite a different set of studies, and you need to, all of these, I mean, will take anywhere from 6 months to 12 months typically. And some of them might be even longer. So this, I mean, what you look at on the left side, I don't know if you have heard of this. This is a horse called Clever Hands. So this horse was became very popular in the 1920s, about 100 years ago. And people were told that this horse could actually solve mathematical problems. So its trainer said that, I mean, the trainer asked the horse questions in mathematics and they counted out the answer. So they say 4 plus 6, and then he would start from 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. And whenever he got to 10, the horse would actually nod its head and indicate that that is the correct answer. And almost always, it got the correct answer. It was like 90-95% accurate in terms of getting those answers. But then, so, I mean, this happened for about 5, 10 years, 20 years. And then they looked at what exactly was happening, right? So they gave the horse these blinders, I mean, on both sides. And what they found is that if the person who is, and this, I mean, if it was a trainer on asking the questions also, it got the answers correctly. If it was somebody else asking the questions, even then, it got the correct answer. So now what they said is, okay, can you now, if they have the blinders in place, is it able to get the correct answer? So what they found is that the person who's standing asking the question is in front of the horse, it will get the answer correctly. But if the person who's asking the question is on the side so that it cannot see it, it got the answer wrong. So what they came to the conclusion was that the horse is able to identify the correct answer by these emotions or by the face of the individual who is asking the question, and not because of any knowledge of math, right? Basically, that was the conclusion that they came to. And very similarly, I think algorithms also, you have to create that trust. I mean, on the right side, I'll tell you a story of how we build this, right? Very early days of Cure, I mean, 2016, we said we want to build chest X-ray AI. So we didn't have any data at that time. We didn't have any data partnerships. So we got some 25,000-30,000 scans from the internet. So we went to, there are Radiopedia, there are some lots of online encyclopedias for radiology where you can just basically collect the X-rays. You can write a crawler and download the X-rays and corresponding reports or whatever, right? So we got all of that, crawled from a lot of sites and got about 25,000 X-rays. And we trained a model on that. Now, when we saw, I mean, we said, okay, the algorithm is very accurate. The algorithm had like 80-90% accuracy in terms of identifying whether an X-ray is normal or abnormal. We said, okay, we labeled them as normal and abnormal. We said, can we train the algorithm? The algorithm did perform very well, 80-90% accuracy. Now, when we went back, we said, this looks very high for, I mean, data like this, right? So we went back and looked at why exactly the algorithm was calling something abnormal. So we had these attribution methods where you could actually identify which part of the X-ray caused it to call something abnormal or of a certain class, right? You have those attribution methods. So we did that and we found that why these X-rays were called abnormal is because of these red spots, right? And what the algorithm was doing was very simple, that typically all the abnormal X-rays had some kind of annotation on the X-ray, something written on the X-ray, because these are online teaching sites. So somebody has written that this place is abnormal, this is why it's abnormal, right? And the normal X-rays did not have any such annotation. So they had basically no text on it. The algorithm was purely looking at whether the X-ray had text on it or did not have text on it. If it had text on it, it was calling it abnormal. If it was did not have any text on it, it was calling it normal. That was all the algorithm learned. And so it's important to understand what the algorithm is learning. And that is why validation is important, but also attribution methods are important. You need to figure out why exactly something is called abnormal, and being able to mark out where the abnormality is. And that is a critical part of also why somebody will use the algorithm. Because if a radiologist, you tell them that this is abnormal, and without telling a reason of why it's abnormal, they don't necessarily want to use it. But if you tell them that this is abnormal and this is the region that I think is abnormal, that becomes far more credible for them to use. So that's one thing. And I think, I mean, coming back to what I said, that generalizable AI is not easy to build. And first is look for the amount of data it is trained on. And also look at the validations that it has done. Like, I mean, I think multiple questions here about validations and testing on different data sets, right? You have to test it out on a lot of new kinds of data, because it will perform on the data set that it came from. It will perform very well. But if, I mean, as an example, if I have two hospitals, Hospital A, Hospital B, I train on Hospital A data set, it will perform really well on Hospital A. But when I go to Hospital B, that accuracy goes down substantially. And we have seen that. You've seen that when we first did our deployment at a hospital in Mumbai, our actual accuracy was about 65-70%, while on our data set, it was about 90%. So that is including testing accuracy, validation accuracy, all of that was about 90. But in reality, the generalizability was very low, because when we took that to the hospital, we saw much lower accuracy.
So this is a very good sample case. So when you debugged it, find you where your algorithm was going wrong, or did you find it? Did you find a good reason there?
So in that hospital, what we found is that there are lots of false positives. When we start debug that, right, we saw that lots of false positives with the algorithm is actually confusing between different kinds of abnormalities. And that confusion is not bad. Finally, what a lot of people care about is whether something is normal or abnormal. And if you're able to call out normal, abnormal very well, that's still useful. But then, I mean, if you don't call out the abnormality correctly, then people don't trust the algorithm. So that's also important.
Yes. And could you briefly talk about what kind of the many kinds of attribution methods? So which ones have worked for you well, or there's one that you, is there a go-to attribution method now?
So we had, we tried, I remember, I mean, I don't know what is the method we are using right now, honestly. I remember we were doing, 3 years ago, we were doing GradCam. We were doing occlusion methods. And those are the two methods that we were looking at 3 years ago. I don't know where we are today.
That's
funny. So,
yeah. And there are a couple of questions.
Okay, I'll just...
Yeah, but depends on, yeah.
Okay, I'll just take a couple of questions. India is pretty good at algorithm and software side of things. Yeah, absolutely agree with you. How did you start this work, knowing the complexity of medical certifications, motivation? You know, I mean, when I started this, I did not know how difficult it would be. So I think FDA clearance and all of that, I mean, we learned all of that on the way. And when we started it, we said, okay, I mean, there are all these cool deep learning techniques that can really make a difference in medical AI. And why don't we take these techniques, apply it to radiology AI, apply it to pathology AI, and see if we can create an impact. And that is how we started out. We looked at radiology and pathology in the beginning, looked at some genomics problems, and then came to the problem sets that we finally ended up solving. Again, spoke to a lot of doctors, hired doctors, so got a lot of input. Again, the most important thing was that you have to experiment, you have to speak to a lot of people, and you have to take that learning into deciding what the product direction should be. So we started with that. And of course, I mean, we learned about all the medical certifications, hired a lot of people who had done that before, and built it out, got a lot of consultants. So solved those problems as they came up. Google is also making many models for various medical conditions, cancers, diabetes, from iScan. Do you think in future we'll have competition from them? I mean, I think absolutely. I think they are also working on tuberculosis, which is a problem that we work on. They have some chest X-ray algorithms. So again, I feel like, I mean, somebody like Google will be, I mean, if they become competition, we'll die. We'll die in no time. I think the point is that what I've seen is that typically we operate much faster than a lot of these big companies, whether it's Google or Philips or Siemens, many of these who are also building these kinds of technologies, right? And in the long run, I think a lot of companies will probably find more value in acquiring the kinds of technologies that we have built out than trying to build it out themselves. So I think that's where we will see how this market is headed. But yeah, I mean, I think it's There is that risk, and there is the risk of something
and,
else.
And linked question is that is this all B2B enterprise market, or when you talk about end users, end customers in remote area, that is a different B2C market that you can exploit or?
So it's a B2B solution right now. B2C, again, the problem is liability. That if you say B2C, who's going to take liability for that particular instance? I mean, if we provide a report to a patient. Plus the other thing which is a problem about these images is that typically you don't get access to straight time. You don't have. I mean, my dad was in the hospital and we got a CT scan. They gave a CD, the CT scan. I mean, I don't know how to open a CD today. I have no way of opening a CD. There is, I mean, almost impossible to get digital formats of these images. Mm-hmm. I think that's, and if the patient does not have access, there is no point. How can you make a B2C model?
Yes. So the nearest, what the last mile might be the nearest doctor or the clinic which has those equipment and collaborating with them.
Collaborating, which is what we're doing. So we collaborate with very, very remote hospitals. We collaborate with a lot of very big hospital chains. So it's broad. I mean, we can collaborate with a broad range of hospitals, but the people that we collaborate with are the people who own the device, X-ray device or the CT device, because our system sits on top of the X-ray or CT device. So that is how we collaborate. So it could be one center who's got a CT device, or it could be somebody who's like got 100 hospitals and each of them have got 2 CT devices. So we can deploy either of those places.
Awesome.
Do you push out-of-the-box models or can they be fine-tuned by customers? Right now, we don't do a lot of fine-tuning because, again, I mean, the more you start doing fine-tuning, it becomes difficult to productize. And today, our models are mostly standard, except for a couple of customers. They might have some fine-tuning. But what we do is we have different settings for different use cases. Because typically, if you look at an algorithm, the good thing about an algorithm as compared to a human being is that you know about false negatives and false positives, right? I mean, false negatives are something that has got an abnormality, but we call it normal. And false positive is something which is actually normal, but we call it abnormal. So I'll just leave it at that. And a radiologist, and so false negatives and false positives in medical terminology are called sensitivity and specificity. So they are sort of related to that, right? Now, when you look at how a radiologist or a human being performs, they will typically have a specific sensitivity and specificity. I mean, they will not change because obviously human mind is structured in a certain way. But with an algorithm, you can actually change the threshold. So the algorithm outputs a probability. And if you change that probability, if you say that, okay, above 0.7, I'm calling it abnormal. Below 0.7, I'm calling it normal. That will produce a certain sensitivity and specificity. If you change that 0.7 to 0.5, that will change that. So what we can do is we can keep that threshold setting different for different requirements. When we are doing TB screening, we have a certain threshold setting. When we are doing migrant screening or different use cases, COVID-19 screening, we have a different threshold. So we can set up those different thresholds based upon how the customer is using. And that is a configuration that is there in the algorithm itself. So it's not something which is a fine tuning. It's basically something that is part of the product. Do you also make use of any uncertainty estimation methods? Not that I know of. No. As you mentioned that you have the advantage of data, do you think that your competitor can also access that amount of data? They can potentially, but it will take a lot of time because we spend a lot of time getting the data. And it will take them that much time to get that data and they build the algorithms. So wherever we are today, for them to get to that level, it might take them 3-4 years. So by which time we have other modes or differentiators. I assume scanning technology also advances over time. Do you have to upgrade your models to analyze newer scan images from latest equipment? That's true. I mean, so that again, we have to continue working on newer equipment. And continue improving the technology, but that doesn't change so rapidly. The scanning technology changes like once in a year or so. So it's not like, and then even if the scanning technology changes, 99% of the people have the older technology, right? Very, very few people have the newer technology. So while we continue upgrading to be able to meet the demands of a newer technology, we can also, I mean, it does not really impact so much from a from a at this point from a go-to-market perspective, because most of the people still have the older technology. So, but we do update, and we work with some of the newer units that have come out. For example, Fuji has come out with a handheld X-ray unit where you actually hold, I mean, this is as big as this is this big, you can hold it in your hand and take an X-ray. So very interesting. I mean, of course, so we are partnered with them. We are going to be selling our AI along with that X-ray unit as well. So some of those are there. Moving to the questions are over. I'll just move to the next slide and talk about some levels of engineering. It's already 5:22, so I don't know if we should.
It's fine. I mean, the audience is still quite engaged, and I mean, I'm not sure if you've covered a huge amount of ground. So yeah, I mean, please, as you feel comfortable.
Yeah. So one of the things that we learned, I mean, when we started our first deployment was in Philippines. So they have these mobile vans. And the mobile vans have got an X-ray unit in the van, and they go into the community, screen people for TB every day. So they take X-rays, chest X-rays, and they screen people every day. The vans will start from Manila, and then they will go to one community per day, take about 100, 200 X-rays, go to the next community and go on and come back after 2 weeks to Manila. Now, obviously, I mean, the van itself does not have a radiologist. So they take the X-rays and then they keep on collecting X-rays, come back. After 2 weeks, they will collect all the X-rays, send it to a radiologist for reading. So an X-ray that was taken on day one used to get interpreted like 4 weeks later. And what we did is we basically were able to make that happen in a single minute. As soon as the X-ray is taken, it gets uploaded to the cloud and it gets processed. And within a minute, we are able to get the results, and they can then continue with the TB screening. So something that used to take 4 weeks is now happening in a minute. One of the challenges that they had,
I think that moment deserves a big applause. I'm pretty sure you've had many such, you know, life changing, should I say, moments. Yeah.
Thank you.
That's wonderful. The amount of impact, not just in India.
So one of the challenges that they had was, because this van is going into some rural communities, they didn't have good internet connectivity everywhere. They were using a hotspot, but the connectivity was not good enough for them to upload the X-ray everywhere. So then we said, okay, how can we build something for that, right? And this is what you see on the screen is an Intel NUC box. It's like small server, right? It's a small PC, which can, which has got, I think, some 64 GB RAM. It's got 1 TB hard disk. It's got a i5 CPU or i7 CPU. And typically our models used to run on GPUs. Then we said, okay, can we make it run on this kind of a CPU, i5 CPU? And we made it so small that you can run it actually on a CPU in the same amount of time that it takes on a GPU. Again, that is some of the engineering challenges that we had to solve so that they could run this on the field. And today there are about 50, 60 such devices around the world where they're running on ground, where the images are not going to the cloud for processing. They're actually getting processed in the hospital, in the radiology center, or in the van in this case, right? So that is something we had to solve for. One of the things that a lot of our customers said, that we don't have any way to view the results that you have, because they don't, I mean, if you look at these TB programs, they don't necessarily have a system to view all the results. So we built out an end-to-end patient management system, almost like an EMR system, where you can register a patient, you can enter their symptoms, enter their, capture their X-ray. In fact, some of these places, they only had analog X-rays. So typically, I mean, think about it this way, that you've got the analog X-ray where you only produce the film, that film that you get. But most of the X-rays nowadays are the digital X-rays, where you actually have a digital version of that. You don't actually produce the analog version. Hospital might still give you the film, but actually the original image is a DICOM image, a digital image. But there are still so many places in India and Africa where you have the analog X-rays. So we had to build out a capability where you can actually take that film, you can put it on a white box, the white box that you see in the hospital. You can take a picture of that using a mobile phone app, and then we can process that. So we built that out, and that was something that is now live in about 30, 40 sites. So, I mean, the point I'm coming to is that, I mean, as we have built out a lot of different features, right? I mean, for example, in looking at when we were doing trauma and stroke, so we deployed at this hospital in Assam. It's in the foothills of the Himalayas. And their stroke is very prevalent. So these people come into the hospital, they get a CT scan. The CT scan takes about 2-3 hours to read. And what we're able to do again, able to within a minute, able to read that scan. And rather than send it back to the radiologist, back to the system, we actually send a text message, a telegram message to the radiologist on their phone or a WhatsApp message. We're able to identify the abnormal areas and we're able to say this is a trauma patient and you should look at that patient immediately, or a stroke patient, you should look at that patient immediately. And something again that used to take 2-3 hours, because for a stroke patient, 2-3 hours is life or death. And being able to do that in a minute radically changes the workflow for the emergency physicians and health workers. So we built out, over the years, on-premise, on-cloud processing, we built out mobile phone apps, the ability to take a picture, connection with a messaging system, Telegram messaging system, WhatsApp system, and a lot of other things which actually have to be built out to make this a reality. And I think that integration is critical, that seamless workflow integration is critical. And we have to make sure that we are providing all of that to an end user. And which is where I was saying that the algorithm itself, the deep learning algorithm, is probably only about 20% of the overall offering that we have. We have built out so many different layers so that finally, if I just give an algorithm to an end user, they don't know how to use it. Right? I have to build everything around it to make it usable for that individual, whether it is through WhatsApp, Telegram, whether it is through a mobile phone application, or a browser-based application, or integrating into their EMR systems or RISPAC systems. So we have done all of that. And that makes it critical. And I think from an AI perspective, SaaS perspective, you have to, that's a very important part of the AI journey, right? Because people are not buying AI. I mean, they are buying the usage of that. We're not, I mean, Gmail has so much AI in it, but we don't care about that, right? We care about using Gmail. Or LinkedIn has got so much AI in the back end. I mean, in terms of what they recommend, people they recommend, that you know, all of that. But we don't care about that. We don't care about the features that you get. And the AI should be completely invisible. And that is the reality in healthcare also, that the more you can make the AI invisible, the more success you will have as a product.
And quickly, so when you talked about sending an SMS to the patient, to the doctor who treats the trauma patient, there has to be now a confidence score. I mean, if there are, if you start sending too many false positive or near false positive, it's not even calling it false positive is not the right. It's like the person doesn't need emergency care, but you are sending that he needs emergency, versus person needs, but you're not sending that person. So does that boil down to the same specificity, false positive, true positive case, or you need different kind of calibration tools for this?
So you need, I think finally what we don't give a score. So one of the things that is, again, it's a design question, and I'll come to that in a couple of slides, is that it's a question of what is output looking like, right? One way to say is I'll give you a score. I say the probability of something is 70%, right? And score from 0 to 100, but we don't know how to use that score. I mean, whether 60, I should do something, 70, I should do something. So
exactly.
Give a score. We say it's either yes or no. We say either there is a bleed or no bleed. Either there is a stroke or no stroke, right? So that is the first thing. And whenever you do that, you are actually taking a risk. I mean, there will be some cases where you will have a false positive where you are saying that, okay, there is a stroke, but there is no stroke in reality. Yeah. There will be some cases where you are taking a risk and where you say that there is no stroke, but there's actually a stroke. Now we have to account for that second case, false negative, where you say that there is no stroke, but there was a stroke, because that is the risky case. That is where the patient could die if we don't make the right decision. So what we have done is tune our models and set up the thresholds in such a way that the false negatives are very, very low, like 1 in 1,000 kind of.
Yes.
But the false positives are a little higher. Again, that's a design question. How do you set that up? Right? So, but
you have that set is that how, up. So every setting, every particular deployment might involve the threshold until, you know,
we don't do threshold tuning at a deployment level, but we have thresholds for different use cases. Like tuberculosis screening, there's a certain threshold. If you're doing if you're doing, let's say, migrant screening, that's a certain threshold. If you're looking at diagnostic center, they have a different threshold. So there is a setting for different use cases. If there is something that comes in new, then we probably have to set up a threshold there as well.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Yep. That's very practical.
Then I'll come to, I think, the last couple of slides, right? So this is exactly what you asked, Nishan, that
okay.
What would you choose, right? One is the, I mean, a 99.9% sensitivity and a 40% specificity. So 99.9% sensitivity means that only 1 in 1,000 times you will actually miss a bleed. Let's say you're looking at stroke case, right? 1 in 1,000 times you'll miss a stroke case. 40% specificity means that you'll have 60% of the false positives. So there are two stroke cases, but actually have showing five, right? So that is one. Second is 95% sensitivity and 90% specificity. So 95% means that 5 out of 100 cases will have a false negative. So 5 out of 100 stroke cases will not be identified by the algorithm. But the number of false positives is very low. So out of every stroke case that you identify, the number of false positives is much, much lower, right? It's 40% to 90%. So you might have a
Well,
much.
I'm just putting aside comment that it's amazing that you can read those two words and think in terms of false and I need a table to the right, actually. Yeah. But yeah, sure. Please continue. Yeah.
No, so I think, see, I mean, basic thing is that one is highly sensitive, but not very specific, and one is highly sensitive and highly specific. But what would you choose, right? Most people will look at the numbers and choose this, but the reality is this is more effective. I think Abhinav already said that here, right? This is far more effective because if I'm able to show that 99.9% sensitivity, I don't need to care about the 40% specificity. I don't need to care about those 40% cases. Because I know that those cases are, there is going to be hardly any false negatives in those cases. Whereas if I have this, I have to basically look through every case because there are lots of false negatives and I don't have the confidence that the algorithm can perform well even on a single case. So that is where it is. I mean, these 40% cases can actually be avoided because you don't have to read them. You know, the algorithm is performing really well. And so this case is actually far more effective than this one, even though perspective this looks better, and these are basically the same algorithm though. I mean, the same algorithm, just a different threshold that you're setting.
A is better than B.
A is better than B. A is better. Actually, yeah, you cannot see my screen. Yeah, but A is better than B. There is, I mean, again, a lot of other. I mean, I'll probably skip this slide, but there are questions around how do you present this information to a user. I mean, if you show the abnormal regions like this, then the user cannot see what is underneath it. You show something like this, again, you are obscuring some things, right? So how do you show the outputs and how do you design the algorithm? How do you set the threshold? This is how we actually show the results now. So
By user, you mean the doctor here, radiologist here, or?
yeah, doctor, radiologist, could be whoever the end user is. And so I think that's the last point that I wanted to make, is that design of these systems is also critical. So we don't think about the design aspect. I mean, typically when we are, I mean, data scientists and engineers, we talk about data science, we talk a little about engineering, and we don't talk about design at all. But design is also very critical to make sure that the design is set up in a way that it is seamless for the user to use. It is effective for the user, like setting up the sensitivity and specificity thresholds to make sure that the false negatives are minimized. That kind of design is critical. And also the visual design of how the information is presented to the user is all very critical. So again, that is an important part of how these products are delivered to the end user. And so I think from an AI perspective, if I look at what makes an AI product good, is that at least in healthcare, peer review is critical, validation is critical, validate on multiple data sets, multiple hospital data, seamless integration is critical, engineering, the backend engineering is very important. Should be designed well, and design is a critical part of making the product a success. So,
Another word for design might be user experience. Is that
user experience also, yeah, could be, yeah, you could call
the
it
user
user.
interface and the UI UX? Those two terms capture what you mean by design, or there's something more?
There is, I mean, I think that'll capture what I mean by design. I think user experience, user interface, in some ways captures, because some of these things are a little bit more than that, right? Because what you are doing, for example, when you're designing what the false positive, false negative rate would be, that does not come in either of the user experience or the UI. Because that's not, I mean, if you get a UI designer or a UX designer, they'll not look at that particular part of the
A
problem.
typical UX case one, but yeah, so there is sort of the next of UX to have to think about these scores and all the positives.
So I will, that is about it. That's about it from my side. Any questions, happy to answer them.
I think the audience is, more than satisfied, and we covered a huge amount of ground. And Prashant was so open and clear and in-depth coverage of every topic, every question. This was one of the most amazing sessions we had. Audience too, thank you so much. There are 18 people still watching.
So surprising. So 18 people still around.
It's 1.5 hours more than that. Thank you so much for staying and asking so many deep questions. Any hiring going on in the company? What all teams you have in the company?
We are always hiring. We have a data science team. We have a engineering team. We have a regulatory team. We have a customer success, sales, and then finance, legal, HR, and all of that. So,
can provide feedback. So I have one final question. So you have seen the, you talked about the 20-80 part, the 20 part being the actual technology and 80 part being making it consumable, and probably the slide sizes, several aspects of making it consumable. So you covered that. The other thing is that you started off at a time at 2016, I think, 2017, where deep learning was clearly, it had a, in the field of vision, it had a very clear impact and people had belief in it. But the NLP probably this model worked to it, was there. But so my question is that you started with a team which was raw at that time, and you were experimenting both with the technology and the business level. So what aspects of this team, maybe at the tech level, stood out? I mean, if you had to find a unifying characteristics of everybody who did good tech with deep learning in your team, have you ever thought about it? What are there a set of common factors that stood out? The way they tackled problems, the way they looked at these problems or changed their approaches of solving.
So, when I started Cure, at that time, computer vision and all these technologies, deep learning was very, very new. And hardly anybody in India, I could hire directly who had a lot of experience in doing that, right? Nobody. So what we did then, I did then back then is hire a lot of really, really smart freshers. From IITs, IIT computer science kind of backgrounds, right? And people who have coding backgrounds, who are very good at looking at open source technologies, learning open source technologies, them, and put them into this. And together we read a lot of papers, we figured it out, we solved, and people learned. Obviously there is a lot of data, a lot of courses online, a lot of information online, papers online. So you can read all of that. There is a lot of open source code that is available. And we took it from there. So I think and this is from, of course, 4 or 5 years back, and we of course built that out. Now, of course, I assume that things are different. And if you want to go out and hire people in computer vision, a lot of people have experience in computer vision. But I think, as a data scientist, I feel like the key thing that you need to do is scientist part is very important. And when we look at a lot of people that are doing, coding, engineering, you have to really experiment a lot. You have to try out different things. You have to always be looking for what is happening in the data, right? You have to always be willing to look at the data itself and visualize the data and understand the data. So, and do also a lot of domain learning, because what I'll tell you, if you look at, talk to our engineers, our data scientists who have been working on chest x-rays or head CTs, they can today read x-rays as well as a radiologist. I'll not be surprised if they might be even better than radiologists. And they have spent so much time looking at data. So I think those are some of the important characteristics that I think the ability to learn is important, because so much information is out there. You should be able to learn new things and adapt to new things. Having an open mind, having an experimentation mindset is important. willing to dig deep, willing to look for data, having that curiosity to go deep, right? And to understand what exactly is happening, why is the algorithm behaving in a certain way, why are you doing this? So I think those are all critical skills. And I would probably say those soft skills are more important than the hard skills, because people will learn. People will learn. I mean, if you're hiring these smart people, they will learn the latest technology. Anyway, the technology is changing so much. When I was doing my PhD to now, I mean, we've gone through like 7-8 different layers of different kinds of technology that have come about, right? And change again. It'll change again. So, but having that mindset to do all these things matters.
Yeah, that's a wonderful answer. It summed up almost all aspects of what being a scientist or a exploratory researcher or a data scientist is about. Curiosity, persistence, ability to learn, change your... That's great. If anybody in the audience has any questions, please, we'll take one more, or we'll be... Okay, thanks a lot. Thanks a lot, everybody in the audience, and thanks a lot, Prashant, for this wonderful talk, for agreeing to give this talk and covering this amount of information coverage. I don't think is accessible to most, unless they are very closely working with you or medical AI company. So thank you for educating all of us about this field and the business.
Thank you so much for having me here, Nishant. It was a fun session. And hope everyone enjoyed it.
Thanks a lot. Yeah, thanks a lot, everybody. I'll now close this session. Yeah, thank you again.
Bye.
Stay updated. The talk will be available on YouTube. You can watch it later. 2. Bye bye. Thank you.
Bye.